Howdy, folks. I'm Jenny Geist, and happy June, in the month where companies try to figure out how to turn Juneteenth into a whitewashed marketable sale holiday, and where the Pride Month section at your local Target is back, but way smaller and more hidden than ever before. Most importantly, if you're a gamer, that means you got the yearly Summer Games Fest livestream. E3 used to be this time of year, and then they doxed people, and then a pandemic happened, and then they went out of business, and now that mediocre option has been replaced by an arguably even worse option. Hooray in shitification! While E3 at least gave those involved in the industry a chance to mingle, ask questions, and celebrate their craft, Jeff Keighley has pigeonholed himself into the sole spokesperson of the industry through these completely digital shows marred by a stale corporate vision. Specifically, the vision of video games being an art form on par with film. Right? We're just as valid as movies, aren't we? Please? I know we're new and have a bad reputation, but we're basically the same as Hollywood, and we can prove it. We also don't let our presenters speak up against genocide. Okay, if there's one thing that's really become a pet peeve of mine in recent years, it's when one medium is oh so desperate for validation from another medium, or just validation altogether. I understand the instinct among creators to want to mingle with those who work in different industries. There's certainly positivity that can come from that. But it often feels more cynical, like games are trying to borrow some prestige from the more established industries. Either way, though, it's a trend that is both cringy to audiences and detrimental to gaming as a whole. And to understand the nuance of why, we should probably actually look at why this need for validation exists in the first place. So first off, let's answer a question that's haunted gaming forums and Twitter debates for years. Are video games art? I mean, yeah, but... Personally, I'm not the kind of person to look at a medium and say it's not art, because I think it's extremely bold to write off the entirety of a medium based on one's own preconceived notions about it. Film, TV, music, theater, photography, literature, immersive entertainment, games, etc., all have the capacity to be incredible forms of art, oftentimes due to the strengths of their own medium. You can't do Shakespeare as a video game, but you can't do Tetris as a stage play. One of those shaped the landscape of popular culture across the world for centuries, and one of those is an experience so transfixing and compelling that people would see it when their eyes closed. Are those not both artistic feats accomplished only through the strengths of their respective mediums? So yeah, I think claiming that one medium is inherently inferior is silly. It's also not usually that deep, in my opinion. You could argue that influential figures speaking out against a medium might tarnish its reputation, one of the most notable examples being Roger Ebert's 2010 statement that video games are not art, something that still occasionally sparks debate to this day, 11 years after Bro's death. He spoke of how the medium of gaming was often used to house other forms of art within its interactive stable, but that the interactivity itself isn't art, and that it will likely never produce an artist or creation that's spoken about throughout history like the poets and artists of the past. Now, I obviously don't agree. Interactivity can be used to tell stories and elicit emotions that are unique and compelling. The go-to examples for many are The Last of Us and Nier Automata. One utilizes point of view to force one not just to empathize, but to take part in an action you would usually never consider, and one forces the player to confront their role as the sole agent keeping a story alive. However, I think this principle applies equally to more intuitive works like Super Mario Bros. It may not try to challenge you narratively, but the methodical design of a platforming level and how it can be balanced with the engagement of a player, creating an experience that elicits the same emotions out of people from all walks of life, that's art, baby! One guy disagreeing does not take that away, because for all the yapping one could make about how he's hurting the reputation of the medium's still truckin'. Super Mario Bros. Still exists, The Last of Us and Nier Automata still got made, even after Roger Ebert's comments. They didn't need the validation of one who specializes in another medium to become resonant works of art. They needed those who specialize in their own field to do their own thing. That's just a broad stroke, though. I'm obviously being a bit glib to make a point. I understand why people who have dedicated so much of their life to artistic endeavors might take genuine offense to a notable figure implying those endeavors don't have worth. I also think it is totally fine for Ebert to not personally care for games, because even though his exact reasoning was reductive, there is a lot to actually criticize about the games industry and the works of art that are the most prescient within it. I'd even argue that a lot of what gives gaming its poor reputation is self-inflicted. Games are an industry where the most popular works are extremely consumable consumerist. Before the indie game boom of the 2010s, most of the iconic and influential works that existed fell into the hands of larger publishers or studios, who inherently wouldn't have an interest in challenging their player base. Subsequently, the largest gaming partnerships and publications often exist to support that consumerist cycle rather than critique or comment on it. On the internal side, there is also the lack of structure and consistency in how the developers behind these works are treated. In the earliest days of gaming, the identities and intentions of those who created video games were outright obscured, such as Atari famously not allowing developers to credit themselves marketing their releases as toys or products and nothing more. While credits and development details are much more open today, the structure of gaming companies still leaves much to be desired. At least in the US, there are little to no unions of which the different facets of game development are involved in, and that shows in the absolutely abysmal quality of the industry in 2024, as literally thousands of employees have been laid off in the first half of the year alone. These flaws don't suddenly erase the artistic quality of games that do come out, but they do limit the industry in ways that other forms of entertainment, as heavily flawed as they are, have long since moved past. Hollywood, for example, is a union town. It's beyond far from perfect, as last year's WGA and SAG strikes have proven, but the fact that they were able to strike at all to address these changes in the industry is a marked improvement over the game developers' complete helplessness in the face of mismanagement and layoffs. Unions give writers, directors, actors, set designers, and so on the necessary stability to do what they do and create compelling art. With no similar safety net in American game development, mismanaging and layoffs are much more catastrophic. Projects will now take longer because of the worse working conditions, so to guarantee a return on investment, they'll need to be safer and more monetizable. The result is AAA gaming becoming a stale, passionless, and bloated landscape where good ideas go to die and challenging the viewer is actively discouraged. My point is, I think that games are art. I also think there is a lot wrong with games as an overall industry, so if higher-ups want to prove that gaming is an artistic medium on the same level as film or literature, maybe they should evolve their nascent industry in similar ways to those rather than thinking your venture is gonna finally be the only one to weather horrible treatment of workers and lower-risk investments. It's not gonna work out for you, bub. It rarely does. The fact that I'm using the US film industry as a positive comparison is really a sign of how low the bar is. But at least I'm not alone in understanding this. There's actually a prominent industry figurehead who thinks games should be more like movies as well. Except his approach isn't advocating for safety measures or pushing for unions or celebrating non-commercial works or anything like that. It's to look at the corporate side of Hollywood, you know, the part that's bad, and say, "Can you help us? Give us some of that validation, please? Prove that our industry is just as valid as yours, as is." Okay, now let's talk about Jeff Keighley. Born 1978 as a Canadian Nepo baby to IMAX executives, he grew up with parents who were in the Academy of Motion Pictures and Sciences, and with an interest in video and computer games that bloomed as the young industry grew. A longtime fascination in the Oscars and early career in games journalism eventually led to his involvement in the Spike TV Game Awards from 2006 to 2013, followed by the self-funded creation of the Game Awards proper in 2014. Now, I'm going to be completely fair. I don't think the Game Awards are all bad. We all love to rag on how much award shows suck and how above them we are, only to tune in again to complain year after year, but I do think there is value in celebrating the great works of a medium alongside others that work in or appreciate it. I'm not especially versed in the ethics of the nomination or voting process for any award show, but hot take, I think the Game Awards have yet to miss on a Game of the Year winner. Looking at the past 10 years of wins, it's hard to deny that any of these didn't either define the year they came out in, or just prove themselves in quality. I'm not a big Last of Us Part 2 fan, but unless you're one of those losers who thinks it's bad because woke, you can probably understand why the unique story decisions and structure led to a lot of critics loving it. Overwatch may be a complete clown show in 2024, but in 2016 it was a genuinely massive breath of fresh air. Nobody cares about Dragon Age Inquisition, but also 2014 is probably one of the worst years for gaming in recent memory, so what else was it gonna be? In the show's short history, there's been no complete joke of a win in the same lines as Crash, The King's Speech, or Green Book. I'll also give credit to the musical performances. They occasionally do a stupid one, like Imagine Dragons performing the theme song to a TV show based on a video game that isn't even nominated that year, but they'll often do genuinely cool ones, like Hozier singing a song from God of War Ragnarok, Lauren Allred singing No Promises to Keep to promote a sequel to past nominee FF7 Remake, and the incredible Herald of Darkness performance. The Game of the Year orchestral medley at the end of every show is genuinely amazing, and I often listen back to them. I am still mad that PUBG got nominated for Game of the Year over Nier Automata back in 2017 because of medley of tracks from Breath of the Wild, Mario Odyssey, Horizon Zero Dawn, Persona 5, and Nier Automata would have basically been sex incarnate. So there, that's two things I genuinely really like about the Game Awards and will not clown them for. You know what I will clown on the Game Awards for? Basically everything else. Most relevant to this video, though, is Jeffrey's desperation for this show to be as prestigious and famous as the Oscars, without understanding the simultaneous pitfalls in the Academy as an institution and the strengths in that show not being an excuse to get Snoop Dogg to come on stage and say, "These movies are pretty legit, here's a world premiere of the new Ant-Man 4 trailer." When you see him brag about how good the viewership is for each new show, it's pretty obvious that these viewers were not here for the awards, they were here for the sick new game reveals. When you see him bring out an A-list movie star to present an award, there is no question that this person is only here to flex Jeff's connections with the industry and try to get non-gaming eyes on the show, as if Joel McHale presenting an award for best esports athlete is going to elicit any emotions except, I don't know, thoughts of terrorism? Since 2018, Jeff Keighley has invited Jonah Hill, Brendan Urie, Joel McHale, the Duffer Brothers, the Russo Brothers, Michelle Rodriguez, Vin Diesel, Green Day, Brie Larson, John David Washington, Gal Gadot, Tom Holland, Keanu Reeves, Christopher Nolan, Giancarlo Esposito, Ben Schwartz, Simu Liu, Ming-Na Wen, Will Arnett, Carrie-Anne Moss, Sting, Imagine Dragons, Al Pacino, Daniel Craig, Ryan Johnson, Pedro Pascal, Bella Ramsey, Keegan-Michael Key, Nicolas Cage, Jeff Goldblum, Matthew McConaughey, Jordan Peele, and Timothée Chalamet on to either present awards, announce games, or perform. That's 40 different celebrities whose closest relation to gaming is either playing a video game character in a movie adaptation or performing a song that is in a game that is not even nominated. And that's me being generous and leaving out celebrities with roles in nominated games like Norman Reedus or Hozier. It's just so blatantly disingenuous to reiterate that this is a night for celebrating the best of games as a medium when the actual good things that come out of award shows, recognizing the people who actually make the things we love and giving them a chance to speak out about their craft, are completely negated by the actual presentation. I see in theory how it's a cool idea to celebrate what just came out and what's coming next at the same time, but it loses a lot of luster when the majority of the world premieres are shallow corporate marketing maneuvers that cost hundreds of thousands of dollars to include. I see in theory how it could be fun to bring out celebrities who happen to be nerds to be involved in this inherently nerdy occasion, but I don't give a crap about Simu Liu's Gamer Tight 5 when a voice actor talking about how his character connected with assault survivors is played off by the orchestra. It's clear as day that the Game Awards are not about establishing games as a valid art form, they're about making brands seem like they care about the art so you can stop asking questions, stop thinking critically, and buy their next product. The focus on celebrities and premieres is not a bug, it's a feature. That's why, even though Jeff is always asking for constructive criticism after his shows, they rarely seem to actually materially improve. The best they ever got was the 2022 show, which was admittedly pretty good, but it was immediately followed by the 2023 show, which was probably one of their worst. That's enough complaining about this one specific show, though. Jeffrey's big birthday bash isn't the arbiter of these issues, it's just an extremely prominent symptom. Anything can be co-opted into a cynical marketing scheme, even the assertion that games are art. The question that remains now is if this quest for validation can negatively affect the art form itself, removed from said cynical marketing schemes. To put it short, why does this even matter? It's inevitable in any creative industry that prestige will be co-opted and used to market. That's what corporations do best, after all. It's hardly the biggest issue plaguing the medium, it's not even the only medium out there desperate for validation. Within film itself, there are several genres or mediums that are often ignored by major institutions as well, leading to a similar insecure dynamic amongst the fanbase. Martin Scorsese's comments about comic book movies not being cinema, for example. Would I have worded that criticism that way? No, I think it's a little unfair and gatekeepy to say that this wide range of films, many of which are really well crafted and passion driven, are not cinema. I do agree with a lot of Scorsese's thesis, but I also wouldn't blame anyone for disagreeing with that too. But that should be the extent of it, right? You can voice your disagreement, but to still be caught up on these statements 5 years later, when he has only ever talked about it when asked by hacky reviewers trying to spout outrage, is completely missing the mark. He's not the reason that CBMs have become less popular. He made this statement the year that Endgame made $3 billion and Joker got a Best Picture nomination, for Pete's sake. The former understood the assignment of being a fun, fanservice-y romp, so it was rewarded with all the money. The latter attempted the assignment of being a prestigious drama and resulted in an amazing parody movie a few years later, but hey, it resonated with some people enough to be rewarded with recognition from major institutions. Are those not achievements in of themselves? Do they also need to be adored by literally everyone? Why are we, the fans, doing the marketing for these corporations for free? Is that really a healthy precedent to set for cinema as a whole? An even more prescient example would be animation's relationship with the Oscars. It's been pretty clear for a long time that the Oscars don't hold animation in that high of a regard. Almost every year, there are jokes from the hosts about how this category is for children. We'll see blatant snubs like Joe Hisashi having never gotten a Best Score nomination or Makoto Shinkai having never gotten any nomination. Disney will get the wins by default even in their weaker years, like with Brave and Big Hero 6. I don't blame animation fans on Twitter for calling out this disrespect and being adamant that animation is cinema. I also think if you're sick of the Academy never taking animation seriously, you could watch more than just the Disney and DreamWorks movies of each year to get a better gauge of what should have been nominated. Start paying attention to shows that do respect animation, like The Annies, which is run by animators for animators. Or just consider that chasing the validation of the Academy isn't necessarily going to lead to compelling art. Back in the Disney Renaissance, after Beauty and the Beast's surprise Best Picture nomination, Jeffrey Katzenberg was famously desperate to follow that up with more Oscar gold. The animation team slaved away on the most artsy, Academy-pleasing product they could think of, and the result was Pocahontas. You know, the worst movie of the Disney Renaissance. In the pursuit of validation from some arbitrary institution, we got shit. Meanwhile, some of the best animated works of the past two decades have gotten Best Animated Feature noms at most, and while Spider-Verse getting a BP nom over Bohemian Rhapsody or Green Book would have been nice and deserved, that didn't stop it from being one of the most influential animated movies of the past decade. That didn't stop it from getting recognition. This is where I think this attitude can be detrimental beyond merely being abused as a cheap marketing tactic. I love The Last of Us, for example, and think half of the sequel is pretty good, but these styles of games take such immense manpower to create as technology advances. Trying to make a video game that matches the visual fidelity of film takes years upon years and millions upon millions of dollars. And while I'm not saying games like that have no right to exist, an industry that prioritizes those as the most legitimate type of release is not a sustainable one. The fact that Sony has gutted a lot of their smaller or Japanese studios in favor of putting most of their resources toward AAA cinematic adventure games is exactly why they're struggling to get games out right now. When it takes 6 to 7 years and tens of thousands of developers to complete one game, said game is going to need to be safe and enjoyable enough to guarantee a return on the investment, resulting in less games with less ambition from fewer developers working more hours. Again, I'm not saying there's no place for games like Ghost of Tsushima or Spider-Man 2. I like those. I just think they shouldn't be the only types of games that come out. And as the industry eats itself up through acquisitions and layoffs, that's seeming more and more like the end goal. It's a prime example of how using the aesthetics of one medium as a framework for success can genuinely be harmful to the artists that make what we love. Part of a larger systemic issue, sure, but not one that should be ignored. All three of the examples I mentioned, superheroes, animation, and gaming, do at least have one thing in common. No matter how much the big players beg for recognition, there's always going to be these smaller players who actually are taking advantage of their art form without worrying about the approval of some supposed authority. Superhero films made by auteur filmmakers that manage to sneak through the studio system and come out to critical acclaim. Indie animators taking things into their own hands and creating the visually stunning and creatively passionate animated projects that Hollywood fails to greenlight. Indie developers that make some of the most most boundary-breaking stories ever told in an interactive medium. You don't need to just play Nintendo and Sony's outputs for the year and then watch Jeff Keighley's Game Awards and complain about how corporate they are. This isn't a judgment, I do that all myself, but you don't need to just do that. You can also play the weird-as-fuck indie projects you find, or the larger-scale projects with strong creative ethos. You can also watch the DICE Awards, or Golden Joystick Awards, or any of the smaller institutions dedicated to honoring games as they are, rather than games as an equivalent to film. These are the parts of the medium that actually demand respect, and they're doing so by not demanding respect. That may be too much to ask from institutions as complacent as Disney or Summer Games Fest, who'd rather trot out familiar IP or celebrities to validate their own existence, but the good news is those aren't the only options, and they never will be. If you enjoyed this video, be sure to like, comment, subscribe, and consider donating to my Patreon. For as low as $3 to $5 a month, you can get an amazing set of perks, including early access to new videos, your name listed in the credits, behind-the-scenes blog posts, and an exclusive Discord server. The more support I get, the more time I can dedicate to the channel to make in-depth video essays like these. So be sure to click the link in the description below, or go to patreon.com/jennygeist. Today I'll be giving a shout-out to my patrons at the producer tier and above. Those being Ace L, Alicia Stella, ArcadeFlower190, Kira, Freya, Joy Content, Oliver Kirkorin, We Dedicated, Sam, Vincent Coates, and Yinsid. Even if you can't donate, though, liking, commenting, subscribing, and sharing are all still immensely helpful to me, and it means the world. With that said, I hope you all have a wonderful day, and I will see you all later.